famous miracle story is the miracle of the Virgin of Fatima. In 1917, at Fatima in Portugal, a 10-year-old shepherd girl called Lucia, accompanied by her two young cousins, claimed to have seen a vision on a hill. It was a woman, Virgin Mary, who said that she would keep returning on the 13th of every month until October the 13th, when she would perform a miracle to prove that she was who she said she was. The rumours of the miracle spread throughout Portugal, and on the day, the 13th of October, a vast crowd of 70,000 people is said to have gathered at the spot. And the miracle is alleged to have happened. It involved the sun. Exactly what the sun is supposed to have done varied. To some witnesses, it seemed to dance in the sky. To others, it seemed to whirl around like a Catherine wheel. The most dramatic claim was that, quote, the sun seemed to tear itself from the heavens and come crashing down upon the horrified multitude. Just when it seemed that the ball of fire would fall upon and destroy them, the miracle ceased. The sun resumed its normal place in the sky, shining forth as peacefully as ever. What really happened at Fatima? First possibility, the sun really did come crashing down. Second, 70,000 people experienced a mass hallucination. Or third, nothing happened at all, the whole thing was misreported, exaggerated, or just made up. Well, the first possibility would have involved not just people in Portugal, but everybody in the daylight half of the world would have seen it, and what's more, it would have been the end of the world. Second possibility, 70,000 people experienced a mass hallucination. Well, that's not so improbable, but it seems far more likely that the whole incident was simply made up, never happened, exaggerated. Rumours spread. Maybe, well, one thing that happened was that Lucia told the people to stare at the sun, which is a very silly thing to do, by the way. And that in itself might well have produced a sort of hallucination of the sun moving. And if only some people saw that hallucination and told others, the story would have become exaggerated and spread until it became it became alleged that 70,000 people had seen this astonishing phenomenon. So the purpose of this chapter on miracles is really to encourage young people to think critically and to evaluate evidence rather than just believe what they're told because it sounds good. I don't want to give the impression that science knows everything. Far from it. Science is constantly asking questions, constantly opening new doors, constantly searching and changing and admitting mistakes. Not even the best scientists of the day of today can explain everything. But this doesn't mean that we should block off all investigation by resorting to phony explanations invoking magic or the supernatural, which don't explain anything at all. Just imagine how a medieval man, even the most educated man of his era, would have reacted if he'd seen a jet plane, a laptop computer, a mobile telephone, a GPS device. Any one of those would have been called a miracle. We don't have to go back as far as medieval times to make the point. A gang of Victorian criminals equipped with modern cell phones could have coordinated their activities in ways that would have looked like telepathy to Sherlock Holmes. And in Holmes's world, a suspect in a murder case who could prove that he was in New York the evening after the murder was committed in London would have had a perfect alibi. Because in the late 19th century, it was literally inconceivable that somebody could be in New York and London on the same day. Of course, nowadays, it's commonplace. The eminent science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke summed up the point as Clarke's third law. Any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. If a time machine were to carry us forward a century or so, we'd see wonders that today we might think impossible, miracles. The more you think about it, however, the more you realize that the very idea of a supernatural miracle is incoherent nonsense. If something happens that appears to be inexplicable by science, we can safely conclude one of two things. Either it didn't really happen, the observer was mistaken, or was lying, or was tricked, or we have exposed a shortcoming in present-day science. If present-day science encounters an observation or an experimental result that it can't explain, then we should not rest until we've improved our science so that it can provide an explanation. And if that requires a radically new kind of science, a revolutionary science so strange that old scientists scarcely recognize it as science at all, that's fine too. It's happened before, and it'll probably happen again. Actually, it may even be happening at this very moment, because as you may have read, there's an experiment involving the Large Hadron Collider in Geneva, firing neutrons some many miles, being picked up in Italy, and the speed of the neutrons has been measured as faster than light. Well, that goes directly against Einstein's special theory of relativity. So if that finding, if that observation is verified and verified and verified, because an extraordinary result like that would need a lot of verification, if it is found to be true, eliminate the first of my possibilities, if it's found to be true, then physics would have to be faced with either abandoning Einstein's special theory of relativity or acknowledging the possibility of going backwards in time. And both those things would be very revolutionary. The Large Hadron Collider, by the way, is a deeply moving piece of apparatus. It's something that has literally moved me to tears when I went there, because it is such a gigantic enterprise in human cooperation. It made me literally proud to be a member of my species, and I felt the same thing when visiting great telescopes in California. I expressed that emotion in my last book, The Greatest Show on Earth, but unfortunately the Large Hadron Collider was misprinted as the Large Hadron Collider. Even more unfortunately, the publisher's official proofreader spotted the mistake and removed it, and I begged her to leave it in. But she said it was more than her job was worth. Science has to acknowledge that it may be wrong, and it frequently does acknowledge it. It makes successive approximations to the truth. Don't ever be lazy enough, defeatist enough, cowardly enough to say, if there's something I don't understand, it must be supernatural. It must be a miracle. Say instead, it's a puzzle, it's strange, it's a challenge that we should rise to. Whether we rise to the challenge by questioning the truth of the observation or by expanding our science in new and exciting directions, the proper and brave response to any such challenge is to tackle it head on. And until we've found a proper answer to the mystery, it's perfectly okay simply to say, this is something we don't yet understand, but we're working on it. Indeed, it's the only honest thing to do. Miracles, magic, myths, they can be fun, and I have fun with them in this book. Everybody likes a good story, and I hope if you read the book, you'll enjoy the myths with which I begin the chapters. But even more, I hope that in every chapter, you'll enjoy the science that comes after the myths. I hope you'll agree that the truth has a magic of its own. The truth is more magical, in the best and most exciting sense of the word, than any myth or made-up mystery or miracle. Science has its own magic, the magic of reality.